So we have a variety of folks here, some from some instructors from the school, some friends from some of our sister schools in the Chicago area. We also have some of our industry partners that work with one of the wine schools that teaches out of here, and the bartending school as well. So,
good. Well, thank you.
Thanks for
joining me today, and it's great to hear you have a wine program here as well. Because I know years ago, I think wine programs didn't really exist in culinary programs. I like to think it's kind of one of the same. So it's good to hear that. So today, we do is I have a little presentation we embarked on at the winery, because our winery, Charles Crude Winery, my family's winery, is celebrating its 150th anniversary this year. So that's why we have this presentation. It just kind of highlights some of the history in the California wine industry over the last couple of centuries. It's kind of interesting. Small group, so if you have any questions at all, just let me know as I go through it. After that, they're going to have a little tasting of some of my family's wines as well. So we start here. This is actually an artistic rendition of our carriage house. It's a Michael Schwab, an artist in Northern California, who really captures a lot of the historical landmarks within California. We commissioned him to do this. This is a carriage house built by Charles Krug in 1881. We're getting to the meat of this now. So Charles Krug, he founded the first commercial winery in the Napa Valley. How that came about was he was a Prussian immigrant coming over from Prussia. He was a journalist, a radical journalist, to the point where he got thrown in jail. Through a brief revolution, got released from jail. The revolution was not successful, so he escaped Prussia, came to New York, and quickly worked his way to California, where he became chief editor for the first German-speaking newspaper on the West Coast. And then through friends, acquaintances, got some vineyards in the area, got involved with vineyards, got involved with some winemaking, fell in love with that aspect of it, bought a small vineyard in Sonoma, furthered his winemaking skills, started doing some consulting winemaking as well. And then December 26th, 1860, he got married to Carolina Bale. And Carolina Bale's family had significant land tracts throughout Napa Valley. So part of the marriage, the dowry they received for the marriage, was 500 acres of land in the heart of Napa Valley. So Charles Crew didn't waste any time. Pursued his love of winemaking, established his winery, Charles Crew Winery, on that property the following year in 1861, making it the very first commercial winery in Napa Valley. So here we have, upper left is actually his original press. Prior to that, winemaking in Napa Valley was pretty much run by the Spaniards, his home winemaking for casual use. Still the old, the goat skin, skin vessels, something like that, squishing with the feet and so forth. So he introduced a cider press. It's actually an apple cider press that he used. So kind of advancing the technology back in those days. In fact, we still do have that cider press on display at our retail room into Napa Valley. And, by the way, the location of our wine. We've been to Napa Valley before. We've been to the CIA, the Wine Institute of America. Surprise, surprise. Anyway, if you're up there and you walk out the front door of the CIA, the gorgeous building, and you're facing Napa Valley, and you're facing a vineyard, that's our 150-acre estate. So that's where the winery is, and the winery itself, the original winery, is right in the middle of that 150-acre estate. So if you're at the CIA, you cannot miss our winery there. Then an early rendition of what some of the building layouts were in that era. Just to kind of anchor this, what was happening in 1861 in the United States 150 years ago. Lincoln was inaugurated president, the 16th president, and also the Civil War broke out at that time, just to give you kind of a time frame there. Actually, and the other thing is Charles Crewe, even though he was a winemaker, he was also a business person, a sales marketing person, so he had a lot of duties in the winery, so he actually hired a winemaker for his first vintages, and that was actually Jacob Herringer. After that, shortly after that, he encouraged others to establish wineries, others to create the Napa Valley. Jacob Schramm, who established Schrammsburg in 1862, today the Sparkling Wine Facility, I don't like the Sparkling Wine back then. Jacob and Frederick Barringer started Barringer Wine in 1877 after Jacob Barringer got a start at Charles Crewe's winemaker. Gustav Ebaum founded Inglewood Winery in 1879 in a Bordeaux style production. Alfred Tubbs founded Chateau Montelena Winery in 1882. So you have a series of these wineries just starting to pop up in the Napa Valley. We have a little historical timeline on the bottom that highlights some events that were going on in the United States and around the world. This particular one, Thomas Edison, 1881 or 1882, Thomas Edison lights up Manhattan with an electric light bulb. So as we move forward in time, 1870s, 1890s, the phylloxera bug came about, not only domestically in California, but also in Europe. What phylloxera is a root louse that really feeds on the roots of the grapevine. And what happened was, in 1863, French, France and Europe did not have phylloxera there. But someone, whether intentionally or unintentionally, whatever, brought rootstock from the United States over to France and thus infected their vineyards with phylloxera. Because those the native grapevines from France have never seen phylloxera, of course, they got decimated with phylloxera. And the solution for the French were to come to the United States and get native rootstock, grape rootstock from the United States, which coexisted with our phylloxera population here, so it was resistant. So they then brought that back and propagated that rootstock in France. And that's how they got over the phylloxera issues, but it was quite devastating. And then, because there are European cuttings that had come over to California and Napa Valley, at that point, Napa Valley did not have phylloxera. It existed in other parts of the United States, principally in the south and eastern part of the United States. But Napa Valley started to get grape cuttings propagated from European cuttings, because Charles Crewe was one of those ones instrumentally to bring over the wine varieties, the Bordeaux varieties, the Burgundy varieties to the United States to improve the quality of the wine.
Based on what you said, there was most of the rootstock that's planted in France today, indigenous rootstock came from the United States.
Yeah, came from the United States. Mm-hmm. So Charles Crewe planted a lot of European rootstock, and then through time the phylloxera did make it up to Napa Valley, and so around the 1870s decimated the Napa Valley as much of the rootstock as the European rootstock. So same solution that France came about is they planted it on native rootstock from domesticated in the United States. So that's one of the things, and it's actually, you know, we'll talk about it a little later, it's going to rear its ugly head in recent decades as well. Now Charles Crewe, he passed away around 1892. He was financed, because he had financial problems. The 500 acres he originally started with, he sold off much of that, down to what was left of 150 acres. But he suffered considerably from the phylloxera problems. So he passed away in 1892. invested in the winery, basically took possession of the Charles Crook Winery. He did lease it back to Charles Crook's daughters and nephew to continue winemaking there. And that kind of continued up until the Prohibition era. Charles Crook, like most wineries, was shut down during Prohibition. It then started back up again in 1933. It was leased out to somebody else just as a wine production facility because Moffitt's had no interest in winemaking because they were bankers, business people from San Francisco. But they did build a couple houses up there, so they built there on weekends. So other things happening in the country here, we got the first U.S. pro football game was played in Pennsylvania. So pictures here, we have, of course, James Moffitt. And then two pictures of our Redwood cellar that we still have today, built by Charles Crook about 1872, back then. So as we move forward, we move into Prohibition, started in 1920.